Is liberty dying where you live? Escape to Keene at freekeene.com.
Requiring the state treasurer to develop an implementation plan for the state to accept bitcoins as payment for factories and fields. Prime sponsor, the representative.
Swan.
Yeah.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you to the committee for listening to my testimony. This bill is actually very simple, allowing for the payment of taxes or fees in Bitcoin. I'm going to just go over three very basic principles to set a context for the rest of the hearing. I'm going to go over cost, and then safety and security, and then the practicality of a bill like this. So the cost is very simple. There would be no cost to the state. The way it would work would be there would be a third-party payment processor, very similar to how we do it already with credit cards. This isn't cutting-edge technology. This is stuff that many major companies are already doing. And there are already companies out there like BitPay and Coinbase. The setup fee is $0, and transaction fees are $0. And look at credit cards. Credit cards, they have a fee. They often, to set up a credit card payment processor, it costs money to set up. So this would save the state money. It would save consumers, the taxpayer money if they don't have to pay transaction costs. When it comes to safety and security, this is a much more secure way of payment than credit card. Credit cards are, fairly secure. This is even more secure, so it prevents against, any kind of theft, identity theft, any kind of fraud. And then practicality. So for instance, let's say, the state already accepts, credit cards is for payments of fees. So let's say, for instance, right now, I'm illegally parked and I get a parking ticket, right? With this bill, I could, from my car, go to my cell phone and pay just like, if I was paying through something with PayPal or paying something online, through Amazon on a credit card, I could just pay my parking ticket fee right from my phone. It would be totally secure. One of the nice things about the payment processor, it's instant conversion to US dollars. So the state of New Hampshire would never be holding a Bitcoin, nor would I want them to be holding a Bitcoin. I want the state of New Hampshire to only be holding US dollars. And this is a very practical and sensible solution. And I invite you all, with any questions or concerns or anything that doesn't feel right about this too, because this is something that some of you may not have heard of, and I would like to take any kind of questions or concerns.
Representative Ron, can you spend 2 minutes explaining the system so we all understand how that works?
Sure. There are actually other experts who are here today.
I think there are others that...
That would be able to explain it even better than I could, so I would like to...
I'll withdraw my question now.
Okay.
Representative Lovejoy.
This bill is related just to state, correct? Not to towns, because your example of having a parking ticket, that would not be paid to the state.
Well, so it would be for the state, so the town as well.
So your bill would be requiring municipalities as well as the state to accept that.
Just the state.
Okay, but you would
follow. Sure.
Your example of a parking ticket, you don't pay top parking to the state, you pay those to municipalities. So you are talking about only state level here, not...
This is only state level, yes.
Okay.
So it could be for, a speeding ticket.
Representative Ohm, followed by Representative Lehman, and Representative Chance.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have a series of questions designed to try to clarify what is a Bitcoin, what is not a Bitcoin, and how the transaction will actually work in practice through the state. But if I could defer those questions until we get the appropriate expert, I would prefer to do that.
Fine. And then, since I missed Representative Almey.
Thank you. Is it, in fact, your intent, because this is not what it's been in other states, that if you owe the state $1,000 in business taxes, and you pay it by Bitcoin, the Bitcoin operator would hand over $1,000 to us, and whatever that is in Bitcoins, you will get charged.
So if I'm a business owner, and I'm paying $1,000, whatever the conversion rate is, right, to Bitcoin, the state would instantly get $1,000 in U.S. dollars through my payment of Bitcoin through the Bitcoin payment processor.
To be clear. And if the exchange rate is varying during that time and you end up having to pay 0.03 or whatever it would be, Bitcoin instead of 0.02 Bitcoin, that's your problem.
Correct. So the person paying the taxes, whether it's the business or the individual, that's on me. That's my risk. The state of New Hampshire takes no risk. There's no currency risk in the state of New Hampshire.
Representative Lynn,
thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for your testimony this morning. Just a thought. The American dollars are backed up by the good faith and credit of the federal government. What is backing up the Bitcoins? Which, by the way, I can understand some people may question the good faith and credit of the federal government.
Yes, and that's okay. A whole lot of conversation, right?
Right. But what is backing up Bitcoins?
So, I'll be very brief, and there would be other people who could answer this in more technical terms than I. What backs up Bitcoins is the processing power and the electricity costs to mine those Bitcoins and create those algorithms to create the Bitcoins. But I would leave that to other people who could get to more technicalities, even more technical questions.
Representative Chance.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you for coming before us today. You had mentioned that there's a lot of companies that accept it, Bitcoin.
Yeah.
Can you give us some examples of companies that we may know?
Sure. Apple, Microsoft. Actually, I made a list earlier because I was keeping notes for myself. Apple, Microsoft, Amazon.com, Overstock, Victoria's Secret,
Dell,
Subway, Reddit, PayPal, eBay, Tesla Motors, Whole Foods, Kmart, Sears, The Gap, Dish Network, Wikipedia, 1-800-Flowers, which for Valentine's Day, coming up, and McDonald's is going to be implementing it pretty soon as well.
Thank you.
What
was
your
According to the bill, Bitcoin would be used to pay. According to your testimony, Bitcoin would be used to purchase dollars to pay.
So,
if I got that right?
So I'll clarify. So there's what are called Bitcoin payment processors. It's very similar to, you know, when you have a credit card transaction, right? Were you going to say something?
Elaborate.
Sure.
So what you're saying is,
yeah,
the Bitcoin processor would take the Bitcoin, whatever the hell that is, and convert it into U.S. dollars,
mm-hmm,
and then pay the bill.
Correct.
Why can't they do that now?
We don't use Bitcoin payment processors right now. So if I'm an owner of Bitcoins, and you know, let's say I like using Bitcoins because it's more secure than paying with a credit card, and you know, I'm going to Kmart and buying things at Kmart and buying things at Sears and buying things through Apple with my Bitcoins, and I prefer that versus a credit card transaction just because the transaction fees are lower and it's more secure. Well, if I want to go pay some kind of tax or fee to the state, I cannot currently do that, and I have to go through a whole process to be able to do that. So I want to just be able to do it instantaneously from my phone. So it just makes it a lot. We're providing a service to the taxpayer, and at no cost to the state.
Okay.
Thank you. I think we're going to get a so-called expert on the Bitcoin process, so why don't we wait for that?
Any further questions?
Yes.
Thank you for your testimony.
Yeah, my pleasure.
The next is
Good afternoon.
Himself in support of the bill.
I am in support of this bill, yes. It's good to see you all. Especially happy to see Representative Griffin there. Good to see you. And I guess just a brief testimony, and then I can jump in and answer a number of the questions. As many of you know, I ran for governor this last cycle, and this was one of the things that I actually talked about quite a bit. During the campaign, I traveled out to California, visited Silicon Valley, and spent a decent amount of time working around this particular issue. During my campaign, as I traveled all around the state of New Hampshire, I met a lot of people, surprising number of people who are users of Bitcoin. And it's kind of surprising because, you know, it's not something that comes up in your normal conversation at Dunkin' Donuts over a cup of coffee or something like that. But there are a large number of users, and I started to do some research around that fact. It turns out that the first 2 years that Bitcoin was was since the technology had been created, that New Hampshire had the largest single number of users for the first 2 years before a lot of activity started taking off and markets started growing and California started to become a big user, and then data centers were being built in Texas because of the cost of electricity. But still, I say that because New Hampshire has a very large, very active base of Bitcoin users. And it's my opinion, and I think that it's a function of being in this representative form of government, that we listen to our constituents, and when they ask us something, we look for ways to be able to, you know, meet that particular need. For me, this is one that contains next to no risk, next to no cost, and provides a function to your constituents who are interested in using this form of payment. And so for those reasons, I support this bill, and I hope that you will too. I'll take questions. I can answer some of the questions. Specifically, I can answer exactly what this will look like from the constituents' point of processing, okay? So a constituent wants to pay a property transfer fee, or what I did recently, filed a business in the Secretary of State's office. I need to pay that fee. Well, perhaps I wanted to pay that, you know, via credit card. It's the same exact process. I would go to the website, I would enter in my personal wallet information as opposed to a credit card, but my wallet information, click process, it processes the fee. Within seconds, the deposit's made into the state of New Hampshire's account. It's all done through cryptographic technology, so it's very, very secure. It's going directly from me to the processor to the state of New Hampshire in a very clean, very efficient manner. That's literally how it's done. There are additional applications which, you know, may come as the years progress and as we become more comfortable with this technology, which would allow us to do things without having to perhaps visit the website directly. Now, the state of New Hampshire may say, oh, we're going to use a company that has an application. I can now pay in real time for wherever I am, pulling up the application on my phone, sending money to a specific wallet address, and processing the payments instantly. But I think that's down the road. That doesn't need to be pushed right now. I think that just simply going to the website, entering my information, processing the payment is done. The question that Rep. Alamy asked was about the cost of the fluctuation of the currency. And people talk a lot about how the currency is fluctuating up and down and up and down. And I think that that's a very valid question. I think it's an important fact. The practical application of that is that any company that the state of New Hampshire would use to process these payments would be securing Windows. And the technology itself is updating every 15 minutes, you know, normally throughout the time frame. What happens is the company that you would work with would actually secure the transfer during that particular window. At the next window, it would re-up. So the practical application of an individual processing, typing in one thing and to end up being something different on the back is actually not possible to happen. Other questions?
Thank you for your testimony. Questions, Representative Alamy.
Thank you. Just to clarify, by securing Windows, you mean that during 15 minutes, the exchange rate is exactly the same so that you, the payer, know how much you're paying for the $1,000 that you owe in taxes.
Yes, ma'am.
And if I could just follow up, I've been pretty skeptical about this stuff.
Yes, ma'am.
So don't take this wrong, but the company turns out that is doing these transactions turns out to fault the payer, the person that's being paid to.
Yes, ma'am.
In this case, the state government.
Yes.
On who's on the legal hook? You who tried to make the payment, or that company which has now disappeared into to the SOPA?
Sure. Number one. These companies have nothing to do with Silk Road, and that affiliation is not accurate. New Hampshire has a number of real startups who are working around Bitcoin, making hundreds of thousands of dollars, paying thousands of dollars worth of real taxes to the state of New Hampshire, dealing in this industry. So there's no connection between those two. I take a little bit of offense at that reference, because it's not appropriate. The answer to your question is, who would be responsible for that if Visa went bankrupt, which nearly happened in the last 10 years? Who would be responsible for that payment if Discover randomly, you know, turned out to be insolvent? Which, I mean, we've all in our lifetime seen large banks too big to fail, right? All of a sudden the next day become insolvent. So that's not impossible to think. And that'd be the same answer that happens now. We don't ask that when we go and process our Visa payments, our MasterCard payments. It would be the same exact process in this case.
Representative Brown, followed by Representative Zarian and
Lovejoy. Thanks for your testimony. So again, it seems like you could explain this in English probably better than anybody else. So I have known nothing about Bitcoin. So what is... Do you buy Bitcoins? Is that how it works? So how does the money transfer? I say I want to pay in Bitcoins. How do I pay the bill? I buy a number of Bitcoins?
Correct.
Is that the way it works?
Yes. If you're interested in using Bitcoin, you go to Google and type in, how do I buy a Bitcoin? A number of services will pop up, and you would put in money, you know, through your credit card or any other way, through that'd be a digital payment. So I think probably a number of you grew up using only cash. And then we got these things called credit cards, and then we got these things called debit cards, right? Well, we've only ever known debit cards, which is all digital to us. It's all digital money. It's all virtual money. I never actually touch a dollar bill. I always swipe a card for it. How is that different from what I'm doing with Bitcoin? It's the same exact process. And so I think that's why you're going to see a younger crowd, because we're much more affluent in that realm. We've been doing this for our entire lives.
Representative Zarian.
Thank you. Thank you for your testimony. I grew up in a household where cash was king. So, kind of on top of Representative Romney's question, I understand the state gets their money. I understand, you know, you have the Bitcoin account. What is the value? It sounds like the Bitcoin value changes through these windows.
Sure.
So what is the base value of this coin at any particular time? Is it a commodity where it changes all the time? You said virtual. Is it there? Is it not there?
So technically, that's a great question. Technically, the IRS has ruled that a Bitcoin falls under a property category. So just like your real estate value would increase or decrease over time, it still represents real money. But the real estate values increase or decrease based upon market demand. It's the same exact idea. There is a market, and the same market principles apply to the creation and to the distribution of Bitcoin. And the market ultimately pushes the price of it. A few weeks ago, we saw a spike because Russia's ruble was crashing, and Russia was transferring ruble into Bitcoin. Okay, they're starting to buy Bitcoin. That pressure, that market demand drives the price up. It's the same thing. Just like you know, any real estate transaction, otherwise, the market drives what that price is ultimately.
So if I buy Krugerrands or gold coins or bullion, I have a physical asset.
Sure.
Physical asset.
Sure.
So if I convert cash into Bitcoin, do I have a physical asset, or is it a virtual asset that I never really see, and it's just based on a presumed value at any given time? Based on volume of what someone buys.
I mean, it's the same market demands that any other currency that we face today. For instance, we have massive amounts of money being made in currency trading, right? If I buy a yen today because it's up or down, it's virtual money. No one's ever touching that. But market demand is influencing that
transfer. This question is, if he buys gold,
yes,
he holds it.
Yes.
But if he buys bitcoins, he wants to know.
He can hold it too.
It's a piece of property.
It is an electronic bit.
Right. Okay, so it's not a physical asset.
Correct.
It's an electronic asset.
It can be stored on your hard drive, and it says, it's...
Just one final quick follow-up. So what backs that up? If there's some type of electronic crash or something similar to Enron, where they were buying all this stuff, and then all of a sudden there's nothing to back up the value...
And that
seems it could be a huge systemic failure, or a huge financial failure. Like Representative Wally said, someone's holding the bag because it's based on a virtual currency, not on a hard asset such as cash or gold or silver or copper.
Sure. Two answers. Number one, this is why I applaud Representative Schlein for this piece of legislation, because it avoids the state of New Hampshire ever having to incur any of that risk. The state of New Hampshire never faces that risk. So that may be, from an investor's perspective, a valid fear. But from the state of New Hampshire's perspective, it's not. Because they're never going to be handling Bitcoin. They're never going to hold it. They're never going to have any of that market risk. So from your perspective, that doesn't have anything to do with the state of New Hampshire.
Representative Lovejoy, and we're going to have to move on.
I'm confused, making clear confusion.
Sure.
Both you and the previous person have said that it's more of a system of transferring, that we would get cash. Yet when I read this bill, it says that we will accept Bitcoin. It doesn't say that we will work with a Bitcoin processor who will then give us cash. The bill says that we will accept Bitcoin, but that is different from what both you and the previous person said.
So I understand that. So let's look at the language of the bill.
Okay.
It says that essentially what we're doing is requiring the state treasurer to develop an implementation plan. The only real practical way for that implementation plan to happen today is for there to be a contract with a third-party service who's going to be able to handle these transactions. A company like BitPay, for instance, or it could be Coinbase, or it could be any other number of companies that are out there. And what their function is to translate the Bitcoin into dollars. The practical part of this bill starts at the second phrase, which is to accept Bitcoins. Because I don't know if you could write a bill that said to accept dollars through Bitcoins back to dollars, right? So it's, and if I guess you need to clarify the language, then maybe that's a consideration. But essentially, it's a practical way of simply stating that when I go to your website and I'm paying for state taxes and fees, I'm passing Bitcoin on and it's getting translated into dollars. I think that back part sort of fits under sort of the how the sausage is made more than it is on the front, but I'm not a rep, so I'm not the expert on that.
I think that, or I guess it's not a question, I'm making a statement, so I can say it.
Perhaps another chance.
Quickly, thank you for testifying. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Well, do you know, this may be a deliverable for us later, on the surface it sounds like a good idea with no risk. If we could find a processor that would guarantee that 15-minute window that New Hampshire will not lose any money. Do we know of any processors? We had talked about Discover if they didn't pay.
Yeah.
Are there any processors that guarantee that we would not lose money?
Almost all of them will do this as a part of their value proposition. I mean, there's a lot of them backed by the largest investment banks in the world. I mean, they're backed by Goldman Sachs. They're backed by a lot of the largest investors in the world. In fact, a lot of the credit card companies, which we're talking about, have huge stakes in the virtual currency world because they recognize that this is what's happening. When companies like Apple, Microsoft, and Dell, and McDonald's, and on and on and on and on and on, right? I think
time's
going to happen. Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Seeing no more questions in the next one. I want to remind the people here, the governor goes on at 1 o'clock to present her budget. We are going to be there. I'm going to cut our meal shot short. So we're going to go to 12:30. We have seven cards.
We have six that are in favor, one in opposition.
We have seven cards left. if you divide that into 25 minutes, and I'm holding it to 25 minutes. So, members, don't repeat questions. People are testifying. If you've heard the information, you don't have to repeat it again. If you have written testimony, summarize it. The next one is Christopher David from Coin Box, New Hampshire Business. And he's in support of it.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thank you to the committee. My name is Christopher David. I'm an entrepreneur. I run a small Bitcoin consulting company that in the past few months I've moved from Silicon Valley to Portsmouth, New Hampshire. I moved in part because I believe that New Hampshire can and should be the hub of Bitcoin technology. Made that decision in part looking at the available consumer data about New Hampshire having one of, if not the highest rates of consumer usage of Bitcoin per capita of any state in the country. And just liking the fact that New Hampshire already obviously has a bias toward being close to the people in just the size of its legislature and the fact that I'm testifying for the first time ever here. And Bitcoin, I think, goes along with that. It's a very kind of people-focused, empowering technology. I'm here to support House Bill 552 for two main reasons. One is that it will help support job growth in New Hampshire. I've brought with CoinVox, we've created four part-time temporary jobs. We're looking at creating 10 part-time and two full-time jobs in the next year. We are happily based here in Portsmouth. I can tell you from the many conversations that I've had with other Bitcoin entrepreneurs around the country, I've been to many Bitcoin conferences, I've spoken and presented on the intersection of Bitcoin with politics and governance in particular at conferences in California, Washington, D.C., and Europe, that there is a large interest among the Bitcoin community in identifying which jurisdictions are going to be the friendliest jurisdictions for Bitcoin. The New York State Department of Financial Services, part of the biggest kind of conflicts in the Bitcoin community in the past 6 months, has been the NYSDFS passing and considering some relatively onerous Bitcoin regulations, and there's just been a massive outcry and but also a positive critical engagement of the Bitcoin community engaging in conversations with regulators. But a lot of the entrepreneurs that I've spoken with personally, and this is reflected in a lot of the Bitcoin news coverage, has been if anything passes in terms of a regulatory structure that New York was considering, a bunch of New York state businesses would have to leave the state, and that a lot of national and international Bitcoin businesses would have to deny service to New York customers. I do not want to see anything like that happen to New Hampshire. I think that New Hampshire can and should lead the way in Bitcoin adoption. Specifically to this bill, it addresses the commitment that the, I read on the New Hampshire Department of Revenue Administration website under the section Taxpayer Bill of Rights. They say, we quote, also want to protect your rights, privacy, and property during the assessment and collection of taxes. This is a new technology, Bitcoin and blockchain technology, and though it's just now starting to break into the popular conversation and awareness, the technology has been in development for decades. It's just now reaching a point where it can be integrated into consumer affairs. The Bitcoin ecosystem is evolving at a rapid pace. You have a lot of institutional investors, especially in Silicon Valley, that are pouring millions of dollars in venture capital. There was $335 million in venture capital invested in the Bitcoin space in 2014. That's up from $96 million in 2013. When we talk about the processes that the state of New Hampshire would deal with, one example and one of my favorites is BitPay, which, for example, has received $32 million in venture funding from some of the top venture funds out there. And just to give you an idea of the level of compliance procedures that go into these types of companies, they hired their chief compliance officer away from Visa. He was in charge of, or he specialized at Visa on anti-money laundering and anti-terrorist financing. And he's previously worked at the Federal Reserve Bank of San Francisco and the FDIC. So this is not a fringe thing. There's a lot of maybe fringe players associated with Bitcoin as it is an early technology, as happened with the internet. But we're seeing the ecosystem mature at a rapid pace. And we're right now just looking for a partner in a state government that's willing to kind of embrace this and take advantage of what is a very advantageous proposition from a cost perspective. I'll conclude by saying that there's just a lot of willingness in the Bitcoin community to embrace any jurisdiction, any state government, anyone who's willing to embrace the Bitcoin community and learn more about this. There's a lot of resources that we, the community, can connect you with. Any questions you'd like answered, any security considerations, we're happy to engage in a dialogue. So thank you, and if there's any questions, I'll...
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate the chance to ask a few questions after having deferred my question. I'd like to get back to the fundamental question. We talk a lot about transaction issues. I'd like to get back to the very fundamental question of what is Bitcoin?
Sure. So a Bitcoin
type... May I ask to confirm my understanding of this? My understanding is that a Bitcoin is a computer-generated prize created by solving a tough mathematical problem. Is that correct?
That is very close to accurate in terms of like a kind of a basic understanding of it. That is correct. It is a Bitcoin technically is a spot in a ledger. It is a decentralized ledger that is public. Anyone can see the transactions that are made. How a Bitcoin and how those spots in the ledger are rewarded is through processing power. So the Bitcoin network is a network of nodes that span the globe. So there's no single point of failure, which is one of the advantages of a decentralized currency, that there's no, in addition to it being just the security advantages to that, there's also no central authority that's able to inflate the currency. We know exactly how many Bitcoins are going to be created for the next century, and what's it backed by? It's backed by math and algorithms and a public transparent process, which still shrouds, you know, the user information of the people who are using it, but there's processes in place for a governmental institution to get all the information that they would need. I'm happy to go further into the technical discussion.
Yes, a follow-up question, please. This is the gold bar. We can understand and see and touch what a gold bar is. We can't see and touch what a Bitcoin is. It's a prize from solving a tough computer problem. That's a book entry in a computer system. That's what a Bitcoin is.
And the ownership in the ledger is associated with a private key. So where the private key is held, that's the like equivalent, I would say, of the gold bar.
So if I wanted to make more gold coins, I could mine gold, produce them into a nice envelope, and make a gold coin out of that. People would recognize it. If I want to make more bitcoins, I'd run more computers to solve more mathematical problems and make more computer prizes to make more bitcoins. Is that fundamentally correct?
It is. I would simply add that there is no way to create more or less bitcoins than are programmed into the algorithm itself. So the trajectory of new bitcoins is set, and then the competition is to see which miners can contribute processing power to the network to get what percentage of those bitcoins.
Correct.
This is definitely going to go to a subcommittee, and we can go further into these things. We have a time limit. It looks like this is so new. We need time for adequate explanation, and therefore, I'm going to let this run for 10 more minutes, and then I'm going to recess it until Tuesday morning, February 17th, at 9 o'clock. I'm going to fit it in before the 10 o'clock meeting ends.
Thank you all very much.
You cannot be back here on Tuesday. What's your name?
My name is Darren Tapp.
Great
job.
Did you fill out a
pink card? Yes, I did. THPP.
Floor is yours.
Thank you, Chairman, members of the committee. I appreciate you taking the time to hear this. I have some testimony prepared, but I'd like to address what seems to be a more pressing issue: what is a Bitcoin? My background is mathematics. I got a PhD from Purdue University. I am very honored that I had a class by Joseph Lippmann on elliptic curves. At the heart of the Bitcoin algorithm is elliptic curve digital signature algorithm. Because of my background, this led me to a position where I could get a deeper understanding of Bitcoin. However, we don't need to have a very deep understanding of Bitcoin right now. What happens with Bitcoin is that there was mentioning of winning this game. You solve a hard problem and you get a reward of Bitcoin. That's one way you can look at it. Now, as more computers come on and try to solve that problem, then that problem would be solved more quickly. And when that happens, more Bitcoin would be produced. However, there is in the protocol of Bitcoin, there is a limit of how many Bitcoins will ever exist, and that limit's just under 21 million Bitcoin. And so, if there's more computer power that comes onto the network that causes Bitcoins to become recreated quicker, about every 2 weeks, there's a parameter in the protocol that adjusts. That parameter is called the difficulty. And so if the Bitcoins were coming out too quickly, right now they're supposed to come out at 25 every 10 minutes. If they ever come out too quickly, then that parameter goes up, and it's more difficult for the same computers to produce the same Bitcoin. So that introduces a concept of scarcity. Once there's a concept of scarcity, then you can address the question over here, which is what backs a Bitcoin? What backs a Bitcoin? Well, the same thing backs a Bitcoin that backs baseball cards. So people pay money for baseball cards. I'm really not sure why they pay that much as some baseball cards they do, but they collect them. And because somebody else will buy that baseball card, that justifies the price of a baseball card being whatever it is. Now, you have a Pam Swiss bar I can see over there. Because somebody else will buy that Pam Swiss bar from you is why it's worth what it is. Now, with a physical item like that Pam Swiss bar, you can make a wire out of it, which would be more or less intrinsic value. It would be a better wire than a copper wire. But that doesn't happen because of the price difference. We don't see copper wires strung or gold wires strung on the thing because gold's so much more expensive. Well, copper serves a purpose. But with Bitcoin, I would call it a virtual asset, and I believe that would agree with the IRS's classification of what Bitcoin is. And so you can't really have it in your hand. Now, there have been, and I apologize, I didn't bring one with me, but there have been these little coins made that basically had the access to a Bitcoin encoded in the actual coin. You have to open it up before you can get that access. But that's the only physical token that's there. The actual Bitcoin is more of a virtual asset. So if you wanted to receive Bitcoin, which is not what this bill would do for New Hampshire, it would just allow people with Bitcoin to do something in the protocol, use a third payer. I would suggest BitPay, third-party processor. I would suggest BitPay. And they would just accept the Bitcoin and make sure the right amount of money shows up where it should in New Hampshire's bank account. If somebody wants to receive Bitcoin, they basically can just make up some random number. This is really how it works. And there's an address that's associated with that number. And so you give somebody the address. And people will pay a particular address, which is, it's technically a number, but it looks like a string of numbers and letters and all that. It's kind of gobbledygook right now. It's back when the internet was young. Nobody knew what an IP address was, and then we had domain name servers, and it became a lot easier. Right now, with Bitcoin's structure, there is no domain name server or anything like that right now. But it just looks like a gobbledygook address. Somebody can send Bitcoin there, which makes this transaction in the ledger saying, okay, this address has the Bitcoin. Now, in order to spend Bitcoin at that address, you need to prove that you know that private number, that secret number you thought of, kind of randomly, and you prove that with a digital signature. So you just basically sign a statement, I'd like to pay this other address, and you sign it with that private secret number, and that gets processed through the network, and that's how a Bitcoin payment is made. I'm in the interest of time, I see there's a question, I'm going to take it now.
I'm wondering what happens, Mr. Chairman, when the 21 million Bitcoin limit is reached.
When the 21 million Bitcoin is reached, it's expected to happen around 2140. So it'd be great if that happened in my lifetime, but I wouldn't expect that to happen. Then there will not be any more Bitcoins produced. People who are playing this computer game or trying to solve this hard math problem to get Bitcoins, instead of getting newly issued Bitcoins, they'll get Bitcoins that come from fees from transactions.
So,
That's curious because, you know, in legislation they say this is going to be the limit, but the next legislature comes along and changes that.
That's
so who sets the.
That's a very good point. So the limit is set in software. Software, like for example, I have installed in my computer in my basement, and that software runs, and it has in the program a limit of 21 million. Now, other people are running the same software. Now, you're saying, how is this enforced? How is this 21 million limit enforced? Now, say somebody says, I don't think there should be 21 million, there should be 21 billion. Okay, that person could write their own program with their own 21 billion limit, but if they're the only one that runs it, they won't affect the network at all, because all the other programs that are running will only accept it if it holds to the 21 million limit.
And if it was successful, it would be a Bitcoin too.
Right. And there are other networks established that are independent of Bitcoin. Like there's one with a 84 million unit limit.
Representative Lehman. Thank you,
Mr. Chairman.
1.5 minutes left.
Okay. Thank you for your testimony. You likened the security, if you will, of bitcoins to baseball cards, as an example.
Yeah, that was for the what backs it.
Right.
Because people now, find out.
Whatever two people agree on a baseball card is being worth is what it's worth. I take one of these and I can go into any place on the street and any place can accept it as being worth $5. Any one of these would be worth $1. I've got 20s, I've got some hundreds here, okay? We know what those are worth. So what is there really to back up Bitcoins other than somebody's good work personally?
I would suggest that as this plays out over many years, which it's set up, this program set up to run many, many years, indefinitely, that the Bitcoins will buy more than this. And I would argue that we do not know what that dollar is worth. Because I would imagine that in our youth, that dollar might have bought several packages of gum, for example, or several candy bars. Now you're lucky if that gets you one candy bar, and I've seen even king-sized candy bars that cost more than a dollar. So when you say you know what it's worth, I can tell you it will be worth less tomorrow.
Last question.
You said that there is no central address like our hyperlink addresses.
Yeah, there's no domain name.
If there isn't, how do you know that somebody else hasn't come up with the random number address that you think is Comcast Cable?
That's just because of large numbers. It's really hard to communicate how large these numbers are. There are 2 to the 256 possible private keys, and then the number of addresses is 2 to the 160. I mean, I could do that on my phone if I want, but it's over a quintillion possible addresses. So the actual chances of picking the same address twice are very, very small.
Our time. We're going to continue this on Tuesday morning at 9, and everybody else that has pink cards will be here. And you won't be available?
No, I won't be. I'll be in Portsmouth teaching. I'll be teaching.
Matt,
yeah. What's that?
Leave your contact information.
Very good, thank you.
After we finish the public hearing on Thursday, this will go to another session.
Okay.
And recess.
Thank you.
Where do you teach, Matt?
Right now, I've got to get to New Hampshire Technical Institute. I also teach at Southern New Hampshire University.
Oh, okay.
We'd like to invite you to visit freekeen.com. Freekeen.com features audio, video, and blogs chronicling the transition to a voluntary society. Freekeen.com also has comments and discussion forums so you can be heard. Freekeen.com.
I should be in Keene, New Hampshire with the Free Staters.